Well, let's go to Canberra now for our political panel, where political correspondent Gillian Bradford is joined by Liberals' Sophie Mirabella and Labor's Kelvin Thompson.
Kelvin Thompson, Sophie Mirabella, thank you for joining us today.
Good afternoon.
Well, Sophie, an enormous amount of detail has made its way into the media from your shadow cabinet deliberations, including details of Julie Bishop's fury with Mr. Abbott over this planned cut to the Indonesian aid program. Let's firstly have a listen to your colleague Erica Betts this morning.
I think we all know who the leakers are, and as happens with leakers, they carry neither the respect of their colleagues nor, if I might say, of your profession, because the people that leak are people that cannot be trusted, and whilst I can't blame the media for using them as a source, I happen to know that the media have the same sort of disregard for them as individuals as their colleagues do.
Would you echo his sentiments?
Well, we all have our opinions about the people we work with and people in here, and we know that you couldn't do your job without information from both sides of Parliament and people speaking. Some people may overstep the mark, but it's part of the operation of the press gallery and the media here in Canberra. That's the reality, and some people tend to be a bit more conservative in their dealings with the media and what they say, and others are perhaps over-enthusiastic. But we shouldn't always believe what we see in the media as a particular leaked story or exclusive. Occasionally, when I read something in the paper, I think, oh, was I really at the same sort of event? So I don't think it's anything extraordinary. And what we were doing was going through the exercise of making tough decisions to make sure that we could pay for the very necessary reconstruction for flood-affected areas in Australia.
Do you feel for Julie Bishop, though, under this circumstance?
Oh, look, it's never pleasant for things to be written about you as a politician in the media, particularly when they may not necessarily be true. And what I know Julie is focused on is doing her job, and doing her job holding the government to account, being part of the leadership team, and she does it very well and puts in a lot of hours crisscrossing the country.
These leaks have created enormous fodder for Labor today. It really dominated a lot of the questions in question time, when perhaps the attention should have been on how the government was going to pay. It's now on how you're going to pay for the levy.
Well, the government needs to deflect from itself and its inability to reprioritise and manage the books. Of course the Labor Party is going to use any diversion away from its own problems, its problems of not being able to manage the books, how they're going to reprioritise, how they are going to get support, and importantly, how they're going to convince the Australian people that the tax they collect isn't going to go down the drain like the billions that were wasted with the BER and the fluff in people's roofs. That's what people are concerned about. They know that money is required, but they say, well, we've had natural disasters in the past, there's nothing new. Other governments, other Liberal governments have paid for it with a surplus, and they haven't thrown money down the drain, and they see Julia Gillard, who has presided over, singularly, over the greatest failed and wasteful program, the BER, and quite rightly, they're concerned.
Kelvin, must be nice for the shoe to be on the other foot. It was Rudd, Gillard, all leaks during the election campaign and afterwards.
Well, I'm not surprised, Gillian, that there are disagreements within the Liberal ranks concerning the proposed cuts. In relation to the foreign aid, last year I went to Indonesia and inspected some of the aid projects, and one thing I was struck by was that people in Indonesian villages like us, that we are on good terms with them and we have nothing to fear from them. And it seems to me that this kind of aid promotes a virtuous circle of trust and confidence between peoples, and I really believe that that's money well spent, and I'd frankly like to see more of it. And as for the proposed cuts to the Murray-Darling Basin, The Liberal Party has always found an excuse not to tackle the problems of the Murray-Darling Basin. This issue has been around for 30 years with increasing problems of salinity, algal blooms, dying river red gums and the like, and always the Liberal and National parties have come up with some reason why now is the wrong time to act. And I think that's very regrettable. I think we do need to act to protect the Murray-Darling Basin.
I actually have an electorate that's in the basin. I have an electorate that contributes over 40% of the water that goes into the basin. I have a direct interest in ensuring a very efficient allocation and good management of the basin. And what I can guarantee you today is, I bet you $1,000, my friend, that by the time the term of this government ends, you will not have solved the problem of a management of the Murray-Darling Basin.
But that rests with you as well.
Absolutely. I'll give you an example. We have extraordinary technology in this day and age. $5.8 billion was set aside to upgrade irrigation infrastructure, to make it more efficient, to save water. A small fraction of this has been used. Tony Windsor admitted today and agreed with coalition policy that the water buybacks were haphazard and had a Swiss cheese effect. They needed to be more strategic. The reality is political. The reality is the electorates in the Murray-Darling Basin are predominantly coalition electorates. And this government does not have a serious interest in ensuring it makes the hard long-term decisions and sits down and thinks about how do we solve this problem in a real sense so that we can ensure long-term sustainability, long-term food security and survival. And we can do this by being smart. We can do this by investing in new technology and using that $5.8 billion that has been set
aside. And Kelvin, I'm sure you'd say you can't do this without the coalition support that they've been blocking you.
Well, it is regrettable that the coalition has been running interference on this issue for years, both in government and in opposition. And when Sophie says the reality about the Murray-Darling is political, that's a shame. It ought to be about the science. It ought to be about protecting the Murray-Darling Basin.
You've made it political.
I think that the representatives of those Murray-Darling electorates have failed their constituencies. They have been prepared to see the killing of the goose which lays the golden egg. The quality of the Murray-Darling Basin has been progressively declining for decades now, and they've always found some reason, some excuse for inaction.
I actually find that offensive. I represent the interests of my communities. They do not want to die. They are very efficient users of water, and they do not want to be out of sight, out of mind of this government. You have made it political. You have said that these are rural communities, these are in the way of us delivering yet another promise that because we haven't been able to deliver on anything else. You've got to be smart. You've got to be smart. You cannot do away with agricultural production. You cannot ignore the science and technology of irrigation upgrades. You cannot ignore food security for Australia, and that is exactly what you are doing with the haphazard approach.
I think we'll have
that your
to. I think we'll have to move
scientists
on there.
Scientists have been telling us for years that we need to do something, but you have done nothing. Tony Abbott has said this is a high priority, but when it comes to the time for action, you've always got some reason to do nothing.
Now, Kelvin, the head of the government appointed the head of the new climate commission today, Tim Flannery, he wouldn't even say today if he thought this natural spate of disasters, floods, cyclone, bushfires, could be linked to climate change. What's your view?
I do, Gillian. The fact is that in the last 10 years, we have had the most serious droughts in this country's history. The climate sceptics said, no, it's not about climate change. Then 2 years ago, we had the most serious bushfires in this country's history. And the sceptics said, no, that's not climate change. And now we've seen the most serious floods in this country's history and the biggest cyclone in this country's history. I believe that these things are exactly what the climate scientists have been telling us all along, that if we increased our carbon emissions, we would increase the Earth's temperature and bring about more frequent and more extreme weather events, more cyclones, more floods, more droughts, more bushfires. We are experiencing the weather of mass destruction. And if we do not take action to reduce our carbon emissions, our children will not thank us for leaving behind a legacy which is filled with Cyclone Yasis and Lockyer Valley floods and Black Saturdays.
Sophie, it's a fair point, is it?
Well, Kelvin I can understand as a backbencher wanting to say anything outrageous to get publicity, but he should really look at the signs and he should really speak to individuals who have been in these disaster-affected areas for generations, whose families have been there for generations, to truly understand the sort of floods that have come before, the sort of fires that have come before, and to use that local knowledge, which is irreplaceable, with actual science, not to use human tragedy and disaster to push a green agenda. I think that's a bit cheap.
Do you think it has increased the severity of these events?
Well, we need to look at science and we need to look at what people have said who live in these areas. And I know, I've heard from some of my constituents, they remember the floods we've had recently and they relate it to previous floods as well. I'm not going, unlike my colleague here, to make a rash statement without actually doing my homework and looking at the science. Yep. Because people have died here and I've had my electorate affected by bushfires over several seasons and I fully appreciate some of the reasons why things didn't work on the ground. I am not going to go and use human tragedy, economic loss and devastation to push a particular green agenda that suits my purposes. And I think that's a very disgraceful way to prosecute public policy.
Kelvin, the government said it's going to have to find more spending cuts to pay for the floods and now the cyclone that comes afterwards. It's very likely with the cost of Cyclone Yasi. You put up a plan to start attacking middle-class welfare, saying baby bonus had spun out of control, as had family tax benefits. How's that gone down with your colleagues?
Well, these things are a matter for consideration, and obviously the government will be making spending decisions over time once it sees what the exact size of the task is. But it's certainly my view that things like the baby bonus and some of the family tax benefits for third and subsequent children ought to be grandfathered to the people who've received them already. They were introduced essentially as election bribes, and frankly I think there are more important ways of spending that money, and some of the flood reconstruction and cyclone reconstruction is a classic example in point.
Has Kelvin got a point that Australia's going to have to get itself, the middle class is going to have to get itself off the teat of, the mother handing out all this money?
I just can't believe Kelvin has said that just because families have got three children or more, support for them should be cut. Here is a man who was outraged at the deferral of additional money for schools in Indonesia, yet he wants to attack income to families at a time when we all know that cost of living pressures are extraordinary, whether it's increased mortgage payments, whether it's increased energy costs, whether it's increased costs for education and basic living, and now he wants to attack families. I mean, this is really silly stuff and really going to kick a lot of families in the gut, and it says a lot about the sort of priorities that Kelvin has. And politics is about people with different perspectives and different priorities.
What do you think that says about your priorities?
I think we've got to have good priorities, looking after our children and looking after the future, and frankly running policies which encourage runaway population growth, unsustainable growth, which in turn fuels the very cost of living pressures that Sophie is referring to. I don't believe that's good policy. I believe that we need to target our spending to things like building a skilled workforce, supporting better education, better opportunities for young people, and in this instance, given the immediate pressures of flood reconstruction and cyclone reconstruction, they need to be things for which money is found.
Kelvin Thompson, Sophie Mirabella, sorry that we have to leave it there, but thank you both very much for joining us.
Good to talk with you.